This program is brought to you by the Stanford Humanities Center. For more information, please visit us at shc.stanford.edu.
The Humanities Center. My name is Marie-Pierre Hulot and I am the Senior Executive Officer for International Programs at the Center, and I'm one of the initiators of this series. On negotiating French, Maghreb French, and Jewish identities through literature and history. So I'm one of the initiators of this series with my colleagues, Elisabeth Bowie, who is a professor of French literature and comparative literature, and also with my colleague, Véret Shemtov, who is with us tonight. And Véret is a former director of Jewish studies, and Eva Chernov-Loki, senior lecturer in Hebrew in the Department of Comparative Literature. So this series of talks seeks to highlight narratives of multiple Jewish identities originating from France and the Maghreb. The goal of the project is to look beyond the much-discussed hybrid identity of widely translated writers and scholars and present a more inclusive, rich and complex perspective on the unique interplay between conflicting or coexisting or both Jewish, French and Maghreb identities. So we hosted our two first speakers last March, Maurice Samuels from Yale University, who talked about fictions of Jewish identities in 19th century France, and Emanuela Trevisan-Sevi from Ca' Foscari University in Venice, who explored the riveting question of Jews-Muslims relationship in Morocco. And our distinguished speaker of the day, Denis Kwentanouji, is going to talk about the trajectory of his famous family, the Kwentanouji family. Before I yield the floor to him, I would like to say a few words about his unique background, because Denis Kwentanouji is not an academic profession, but per training. He was trained as a physicist at the prestigious École Normale Supérieure in Paris. He's currently the vice president for R&D for a major corporation, Essilor, which is the leading provider of eyeglass lenses in the world. And during his leisure time, during his spare time, Denis puts on his researcher hat, and he has been studying and writing about North African Jewry history for the past 17 years. Denis is the vice president of the Société d'Histoire des Juifs de Tunisie since 2002. He has coordinated the proceedings of the 2003 colloquium about modernity among Jewish and Muslim communities in Tunisia before the French colonial era, and the proceedings were published in 2007 under the title Entre Orient et Occident, Juifs et Musulmans en Tunisie. And so he's today with us to talk about the trajectory of his family, which is based on his latest publication, his new book, Les Enfants d'Ismaël, Itinéraire Séfarade Maghrébin du Moyen-Âge à nos jours. And I also would like to take this opportunity to acknowledge the presence of two other eminent ambassadors of the Kwentanouji family who are with us today. Laurent Kwentanouji, who is Denis' cousin and an international lawyer and alum of our international programs at the center, and his son, Sam Kwentanouji Samuel, who is a Stanford undergrad and maybe the brightest of the family thanks to his Stanford education. Last but not least, I would like to thank our co-sponsors, the Abbasi Program in Islamic Studies, the Mediterranean Studies Forum, the Comparative Literature Department, DLCL, the Division of Literature, Cultures and Languages, the Department of French and Italian, the Stanford, the Tubi Center for Jewish Studies. So without further ado, Denis Kwentanouji.
Thank you, Marie-Pierre. Thank you for coming to listen to me. It's a long journey from North Africa, Paris, to Stanford. And I would like to thank you, to thank Professor Aaron Rodrigue and for the Humanities and all the sponsors Marie-Pierre mentioned, to invited me to present some research I have done through the history of my family name. I will try to, as an introduction, to give you some indication of the rationale and the methodology which pushed me to write my essay, my book, about this history of the current energy. The objective is to make a link or aller-retour between the family history and the general history of the Jewish population in North Africa. It's an exercise which is more and more popular among historians, is to use the family history when, of course, archives can be found and can be traced over centuries, over generations. I have many, many reasons which push me to write my book. It has been a long process, and Marie-Pierre mentioned it to you that I've been working on this subject now for 17 years. One of the first rationale or cause of my desire to write this book, that the North African Jewry history has a very low consciousness among the Jews themselves from this region, and of course, because they were, as the others, among the Kohen Tanuji. It's very strange to realize that we are the people of memory, but we have a very low consciousness of our own history. It is also an underdeveloped topic compared to other areas of Jewish people, like Ashkenazi or Western Sephardic population, where the history has been studied and the knowledge has been accumulated over years and decades. So here there is a gap, there is a need to further understand what was the history of this particular population. Also, you have to know that we are celebrating in France the 50th anniversary of the exodus of the French population of Algeria, and among this population, the Jews of Algeria. And in, more or less in the same period, it's also the exodus of most of the population, the Jewish population from Muslim countries. So we have to understand why they left, and was the creation of the State of Israel was the only reason of this leaving. And also, as a personal reason, the last Kohen Tanuji we used to live in North Africa died in 2003, and for me it was a shock, it was a catalyst to write this book as well. Finally, also, it was more or less a political reason, or meaning that if you have followed the past 10 years in France and the social and political events, you have noticed that we spoke 10 years ago about a revival of anti-Semitism. But for the first time compared to the previous decade, the anti-Semitism didn't come from Le Pen guys, but from some young Muslims in French suburbs. And it was very difficult to understand why they did act like that. And we asked ourselves the question, is it only the importation of the second Intifada in France? And I judge that it could be much more complicated. So the need to understand the history was there for me, from a family point of view, but from also a general point of view in terms of history, in terms of political insight. I was lucky, I was fortunate, because doing this exercise of retracing an history of a family over centuries is not easy, because it's very difficult to have a unique family name. And it was my case. We share, and I have identified that there is a genealogical continuity between all the members of the family over centuries. And so this is quite a unique and a fortunate situation. It's not possible for most of the families. And also, this continuity is also possible because at each generation, one or several members of this family left some written sources, some written books or letters. So this, of course, is a raw material of history, is written sources. So in terms of methodology, I was inspired by a great historian who passed away three years ago, who was Yosef Chaim Yerushalmi, who wrote a book which has been translated in French, Zahor, who expose the way the history of the Jewish people has been formed over the past two centuries and how it has been built. And what I realized when I read this book, that I was doing the same approach of many all the historians who wrote the history of the Jewish people. What is this framework? It's very interesting. You have to know that the Bible, of course, is a canon of the historical book. However, after the destruction of the Second Temple, the Jewish leadership, the rabbi who wrote the Talmud in particular, did not consider post-biblical history as a priority. They focused on the text, on knowing the text, transmitting the text in a situation they judged as a pre-messianic area. They were not focusing on transmitting post-biblical history. But they wrote a lot of books, a lot of laws, rabbinical laws. And when, with the Haskalah, the meeting of the Enlightenment and Judaism, some Jewish scholars started establishing the history of the Jewish people, they used, in particular, all the rabbinical literature to contextualize the history of the Jewish people. So, the rabbis, the scholar who wrote the Talmud, all the rabbinical texts, did not write text about history, but indirectly, they allowed the historian to build the history of the Jewish people. And actually, I was exactly in the same framework, in the same paradigm. Of course, you know that what also was very lucky or fortunate that we don't destroy books or letters with the name of God. So we buried the written pieces. So the Geniza was a source, and if actually the one in Cairo was a major source of making the history of North Africa and Middle East Jews. I was exactly in the same situation. My family history was not transmitted by my father, by my grandfather, by my uncle. But I discovered in the past 15 years that my ancestors did write books, rabbinical books, which I found in library, and I contextualize them to write the history of my family. And it's about those books. I just give you some example here. Is in Hebrew, they are not speaking at all about themselves in terms of what I'm doing, if I am the son of someone, or what is my profession, or whatsoever. It's just about rabbinical laws, Torah, Talmud, Kabbalah. But there is sometimes some indication about where they live, where are the approbators of their books, in which community they are dealing with, and they are also exchanging letters, what we call in Hebrew, she'elot v'tshuvot, which is a major source of written sources for writing the Jewish history. So, with this methodology and approach, which is totally embedded in the mainstream approach of writing the history of the Jewish people, I did my research. And in particular, in an area which has not been well developed, as I was saying before. So what I will present today is a major milestone of the history of the North African Jews. And I will try to give you a new look of it with always some aller-retour, some round trip between the general history and the family history. First, I will say a word about the origin of North African Jewry and the creation of the Sephardic civilization. I will tell you more about what we call the Spanish Golden Age, and I will speak about two Spanish Golden Ages. I will speak after about the Ottoman Empire, the Caliphate, where the presence of Jews were very important. I will speak then about the evolution of the look or the feeling of the Jews regarding Europe from the repulsion of the Spain to the attraction of France. I will speak then about the colonial area in North Africa, the French colonies and the Jews in the French colonies. I will speak also about something which is not well known, the impact of the Second World War in North Africa and for the Jews of North Africa. And finally, the exodus of the Jews from the Muslim world and in particular from North Africa. What you have to know that the Jews were already in North Africa during the Roman and the Byzantine Empire. We found some trace, archaeological trace, in particular in Tunisia, in Carthage, and of course in the early Christian literature, which was very creative in North Africa among Berber population. So the Jewish presence in North Africa is very old, is 2 millennia. Some people say even it's earlier, we say people, but there is no evidence, there is no scientific evidence that the Jews of Djerba were there after the destruction of the first temple, but there is no evidence. Berber population could have been partly Judaized, but certainly not more than elsewhere. So this is kind of a myth of a massive Judaization of Berbers. There is no evidence wherever in the Genizot, in the sources. The only source who spoke about it was a Muslim historian, Ibn Khaldun, but he wrote this book few centuries after the fact. So there is no scientific evidence. My feeling, of course there is some Judaization, but no more than elsewhere, but like everywhere, the Jews. the Jews were mostly Judean population being Berberized, like the Jews in France are French, the Jews in Germany were German, and so on. And my family name is a Hebrew Berberian name, is the priest from Tangier in Hebrew and in Berber, not in Arabic. So it's an example of a Jewish name. Cohen is typically Jewish from Judea, which has been Berberized, and not the opposite. Of course, we can find some Berberian family names, but we don't have evidence of a massive Judaization of Berberian population. And finally, the Kaina queen opposed herself to the Islamic conquest. There is also some debate among historians saying that the queen was not Jewish, certainly was Christian. What is important is with the Arab conquest, there is no...
Christiana? We're just going to have to wait a few minutes for the lamp to turn back on.
Ah, okay.
Yeah.
I will speak anyway. A second wave of Jewish population came with the Arab conquest of North Africa in the 8th century. And what is important, we can trace this population, this settlement, with some Babylonian scholars going from Babylon to North Africa and even to Andalusia. This phenomenon is the beginning of the Sephardic civilization. You have to know that the Sephardic name themselves because they are dealing with the Talmud Babli. And also, what is the other the early characteristic of the Sephardic population? They were also organized under the Al-Dima law, the laws, the Muslim laws for minorities, non-Muslim minorities. So this early caliphate is the beginning of the Sephardic civilization, which come from Babylonia to Andalusia, and of course, North Africa is a natural way to go to Andalusia from Babylonia. And in the civilization, which is the top of the civilization of the world at this stage, Maghreb is a word for Muslims when they are in Damascus or Babylon. They say North Africa and Spain is Maghreb. And for the Jews, they don't say Maghreb, they don't say Maharavi, they say Sephard. But Maghreb and Sephard is the same word in terms of geopolitical meaning. And of course, Tangier, the city of my ancestor, is at the crossroad of these two, Spain and North Africa. And to give you an example of this unification, this united world of North Africa and Andalusia, there is one scholar, Jewish scholar from Khaled Ahmad in Algeria, born in Algeria, studied in Kairouan in Tunisia, then in Morocco and in Lucena in Andalusia, it's Israq Al-Fassi, who has the first written a book of Jewish laws who make the community totally emancipated from the Babylonian court. So, Maghreb is this. This is a world of the 8th, 9th, and 10th century. And the center of the world is here, is Damascus and Babylon. But then it's moved to here, which is Maghreb. And Sephard is the same. It's funny to know that in Israel today, the Sephardic Jews, we call them Mizrahi, Oriental, but Sephard is Western. You all know that 1492 is the end of the Spanish-Jewish Golden Age. It's very well known in collective memories. But it's more complicated. And there were two Spanish Golden Age, one under Muslim rules, the Umayyad, one other under the Christian rules. And for the formation of my family name, it was very important to understand this particular period. You have to know that the first Golden Age has been destroyed by the Muslims themselves. A tribe from Arabia, the Bni Hilal, a Berber tribe from South Morocco, the Almohades, invaded North Africa and Andalusia and forced the minorities, Christian and Jewish community, to convert to Islam or to leave. The North African Christian population disappeared, to give you the sense of the force of the Almohades movement. The Jews from Andalusia left to the north in Castilla and Aragon, and Maghrebi North African Jews converted or left to Sicily or Egypt, like Maimonid. And it during this period that my family name was formed, a Cohen family from Tangier, left North Morocco to Sicily, as many Jews from Northern Morocco moved to Sicily, which turned to be Normandic. And I found the family name in Palermo in the 14th century. And the Sephardic civilization has been broken at this stage. It was no longer Cordoba and Kairouan, it was Toledo, under Christian rules, and Cairo, where Maimonides and all these descendants shaped the Sephardic world. I have few maps just to illustrate. Here is Bnei Hilal, the Almoravides, and then the Almohades, who forced the Jews from Andalusia to move north, and the Jews from Maghreb, North Africa, to go to Sicily or Cairo, like Maimonides. But here you find a second golden age under Christian rule. It's as important as the first one under Muslim rule. But of course, you know the end, 1492. Actually, the end starts before, in 1391, with a very big pogrom in old Spain, who forced some Jews to go back to North Africa, in particular some scholars, like the Duran family, who settled in North Africa, which has been, at this time, liberated from the Almohades, the new Muslim dynasty. And this Duran family and other scholars revitalize Judaism, local Judaism. And so what you have to know, in 1492, Isabella did not expel Jews from Granada. There were no more Jews for centuries. They expelled Jews from Castilla and Aragon. And if you have go to the Alhambra, Alhambra was never a place where Jews and Christians and Muslims were together. Mm-hmm. It's a romantic view of it. It has been built after the Almohades. And of course, Sicily, because it was Aragonese, it became Spanish. The Jews of Sicily were expelled in 1493 as a Quintanji. We went to North Africa again. They come back to North Africa, in Tunisia in particular. And of course, Charles V tried to invade North Africa. And the result of this, that many Spanish Jewish scholars who settled in Tunisia and Algeria went to the east, to Egypt and the Ottoman Caliphate, as Ishmael Quintanji, the first member of my family. I can be sure it is a Quintanji, because the one in Sicily was in Latin, because the sources were in Latin, even they were Arabic and Berberian speakers. And here is the reason of the title of my book, is a Sefer HaZikaron by Rabbi Ishmael Quintanji. And the son of Ishmael is because of this book. There is nothing to do about Jewish-Muslim link. It's just a Jewish Hebrew name, as you know as well. Then you have a new area, the expansion of the Caliphate, the Ottoman Caliphate, which is for the Jews a new golden age. In particular, under the reign of Suleiman and his son Selim II. Many Portuguese and Spanish Jews went there, and in terms of Jewish creativity, it was tremendous. It shaped the modernity of the Judaism. In terms of political consciousness, with Gracian Assis and his nephew, Yosef Anassis, with some premises of Zionism in Galilee. It's also the way to unify the Jewish law more than Yitzhak Alfasi or Maimonides did. And it's also a new messianism with Yitzhak Luria Ashkenazi, with his message of Tikkun Olam, repairing the world. And of course, what I discovered that my family did participate to this movement, in particular this Rabbi Ishmael Quintanji, who wrote this book, Book of Memory, in Italy, which was not about history, of course. It's a book of memory, but it's just a rabbinical guide for Jewish life. It's a Shulchan Aruch before the Shulchan Aruch, 5 years before the Shulchan Aruch of Yosef Karo. And also I can find his trace in letters of between rabbis about excommunication of a person at the Sultan court. Unfortunately, this golden age ends with the death of Selim II, and it's the beginning of a slow and long decline of the empire. where the laws, the Muslim law vis-à-vis the Jews and other minorities are harder. And also you, we can measure this at starting the 17th centuries, there is much less immigration from Spain and Portugal, and most of the Marano Jews who are still there go to Amsterdam and Leghorn, Livorno in Italy. But during this time, a part of the Roman Empire is quite still very important for all the Jews, is Eretz Israel, where some yeshivot, some Talmudic school remain and are financed by wealthy family from Europe and North Africa. And of course, it's also the place where an attempt of messianism is developed through Shabbatai Zvi, political journey and religious journey. So the yeshivot, the school are financed by people in particular from Leghorn and Amsterdam. And in this phenomenon, I found that the Kohenology took place, a very prominent place, because I found some emissary of Jerusalem going to North Africa to raise funds for the yeshivot. I found one chief rabbi of Jerusalem in the early 18th century. And also I found Kohenology in the debate against Shabbatai Zvi, because you have to know that after his conversion to Islam, some Jews remain faithful to him and wanted to change Judaism. Of course, it was a huge and an intense rabbinical battle. In the Ottoman Empire, I found a very singular period and geography is Tunisia. I found that one of the emissaries of Jerusalem came back to Tunis as his ancestor Ishmael, and participate as a Jewish golden age in the 18th century. How we can characterize this golden age? First of all, the political power was very stable and very independent from the sublime gate. The law, the Muslim law, were relaxed a little bit compared to other Ottoman provinces. A significant Western Sephardic immigration from Leghorn took place, so it was attractive for them. It was attractive because of trade, and Tunis is the largest Jewish urban population at this time. It's a trade place, it's the largest trade place between North Africa and Europe. And also in terms of Jewish creativity, is in the 18th century is where the Jews wrote the more important number of books, Hebraic books, it was in Tunis, and published in Leghorn. And in that context, I will say that my family name symbolizes this Jewish golden age in Tunisia. They were Kaid, or Minister of Finance of the Bay of Tunis, and also chief of the Jewish community, collecting the Al-Dima taxes, the Jizya, and also sometimes involved in diplomacy. So they were Jewish court guy, let's say. They were trainmen between Tunis and Leghorn, and between Tunis and Algeria, they start like that. They were rabbis, and they were publishers. And they published books in Leghorn, and also they published the first Hebraic book in Tunis in 1768, which is this one. It's only one because it was so badly done. In terms of practical know-how, they stop it. And I'll give you some other examples. And also, we have some sources, some written sources, which are quite important because one emissary of Hebron, which was a major Sephardic scholar in the 18th century, Chaim Yosef David Azoulay, stopped in Tunisia in 1773-74 and was hosted by the Kohenology family, and he wrote a book, a chronicle, let's say, about his journey in a book called Ma'agal Tov, the good travel. And I found a lot of sources about the family, about the life in Tunisia, and it was quite interesting. This is the signature of Rida. In that period, we have to know that the modernity start to take place in Tunisia and Algeria much before the French colonization. And why and how? First, you have to remember that in the 16th century, when Charles V tried to take over North Africa, all the defeat, all the failed invasion of North Africa from the Portuguese or the Spanish were celebrated by the Jews as small Purim. But in the meantime, Sephardic emancipation in Langhorne or Amsterdam or the French Enlightenment started to diffuse among the North African Jewish elite before, of course, the French invasion of Algeria. You have to remember that Jewish population in Amsterdam were the first emancipated Jews of Europe, much before the French Revolution. The trade between France and Tunisia and France, Italy and France and Tunisia and Algeria allowed the contact, the intellectual contact. And for example, I found the first French Quintanugi, is much before French Algeria. I found it in the Napoleon Italy, administrative listing of the Jews of Langhorne. At the same time, this attraction to Western Europe and France in particular is to be compared to the deterioration of the life of the Jewish situation in the Ottoman empires, with some pogrom, even with some attempt to modernize the Ottoman empire with what we call the Tanzimat. So maybe I say something very politically incorrect, but if we can find one positive aspect of the French colonization is to it liberated the Jews from the Aldima laws. Then started a new area, the French colonization, which was very, very powerful for the in terms of transformation for the Jews and for my family in particular. I take the quote from Jean-Paul Sartre, neither colonized nor colonizer, ni colonisé ni colonisateur, in the introduction of the book of Albert Memmi, Le portrait du colonisé, The Portrait of the Colonized, to express the ambiguity, the multiple identity of the Jews of North Africa in the French colonization area. Know that the North African Jew became French subject, not always a citizen, but at least subject, from 1830 to 1912 for Morocco. And for the Jews of Algeria, they became French citizens overnight. And I realized during my research that the Jews of Algeria did not ask for it. They asked for it because they struggled so much after to keep it or to reinstall it that they thought they asked for it, but they didn't ask for it. Why we can say that? Because they were allowed to become French citizens 5 years before the Crémieux decree. And only 200 of Jews from 25,000 became French citizens, and because it was trained men from Morocco and Tunisia, we want to be protected by French citizenship when they went back to the countries. And it's a period of multiple and plurality, political plurality, religious plurality, cultural plurality. It's a trade-off between emancipation and tradition, and also some attempt of self-emancipation, either Judeo-Arabic emancipation or Hebraic emancipation. We all know French emancipation, which was the mainstream part of it, but I discovered with other historians many, many sources of attempts from some Jewish elite to build their own culture and not the French one. But of course, with the mass schooling of the French school in Algeria or the Alliance Israelite school in Tunisia and Morocco, the emancipation was much more powerful than the auto-emancipation, the self-emancipation. Also, a variety of political situations, traditionalist, socialist, Zionist, nationalist. I mean, Zionist was very prominent in Tunisia, for example, less in Algeria, but we could find also nationalists, like people who wanted the independence of Algeria or Tunisia or Morocco among Jews themselves. And also a renewal of rabbinical literature and also new cultural and intellectual field I could materialize with examples. Here some examples of the political and cultural plurality from traditionalism to Zionism, for example. You can find also here the first theater in Tunis, French-speaking theater in Tunis in 1875 was built by the grandfather of Laurent. Here it's the network of movie theater in all North Africa was built by my grand-uncles. And now you can find my grand-grandfather with the traditional habits, my grand-grandfather, my grandfather. You see the from very, very Sephardic, Arabic, to French, like it could be Colonel Dreyfus. Oh, sorry, and I wanted to show this is the grand-grandfather of Laurent. with the Ottoman habit. Also, this period is a period of troubles because the social cultural transformation in a colonial period is complicated for the Jews. And you have to remember that anti-Semitism was very strong from the colonial sector, especially around the Dreyfus affair. And this pushed the Jews to change appearance. Some also anti-Semitism remain in the sector of the Muslim population because of the reminiscence of the Al-Dima and also some social and political resentment. How the Dhimmi could become the equivalent of the colonizer. It was very difficult to accept for some part of the Muslim population. And this resentment sometimes goes to violence, in like the pogrom of Fez in 12, Tunis in 17, and Constantine in 34. And the end of the Dreyfus affair, the engagement of the Algerian Jews in the First World War, and the dialogue with the Muslim leaders, reduce the colonial and Muslim anti-Semitism in the, just after the First World War. I give you a picture of the shop of my grandfather in Constantine, which has been burnt in the 34 pogrom. Then comes the Second World War, which is also not well-known period for the Jews in North Africa. Of course, North Africa is French, and with the Vichy regime, it becomes under the Vichy rules as of July 40, with the decree against the Jews as of October 40, and with social, economical, and political exclusion starting from that period. And Robert Paxton liked to say that it was not Vichy who was governing Algiers, but it was the opposite. Algiers was ruling Vichy because, as you remember, the heart of French anti-Semitism was Algeria at the beginning of the 20th century. And for the Jews of Algeria, they lost their French citizenship overnight with the Crémieux decree abolished. We could also see, but much less in North Africa than in Mashrek, a revival of anti-Semitism, of course colonial anti-Semitism, but also Muslim anti-Semitism, which was much stronger in Iraq, for example, in 41 in Baghdad. And also, you have to realize that in the statistics of the Wannsee conference, when the Nazis spoke about the French Jews, they included all the North African Jews. And you have also to realize that already some North African Jewish immigration took place before the Second World War, and some of them were deported in death camps. And I found some family members among the deportees. Of course, the Anglo-American invasion of North Africa in November 42 saves the North African Jews from the annihilation fate. Unfortunately for Tunisia, it was invaded by the Nazis who came from Libya, and they forced thousands of them, of Jews, to work on war camps. And they even deported, with the support of Vichy power, a dozen of Jews and political prisoners to Auschwitz. It's also a very bizarre period because it's a free North Africa with the American and the English, but you have to know that Roosevelt hated De Gaulle, and so he put a guy, was a Vichy guy, Giraud, at the head of Algeria, and this guy abolished a second time the Crémieux decree with a very strange argument, saying that I know the Arabs and Jews of Algeria, the Arabs in the countryside, the Jews in the shops, and I will not give something to one without giving to others. So I will give nothing. In French, it's better. Hein? L'arabe au bled, le juif à l'échoppe. And so, still with in the free North Africa, they did not recover the rights, and also some Jewish soldiers were still in war camps in Algeria until July 43. And it's only when Tunisia is liberated and when De Gaulle replaced Giraud that the Crémieux decree is re-established and the Jewish soldier incorporates the free French army, and they are going to Italy and to Provence to liberate France with other French, Muslim, and black African soldiers from the colonies. I give you an example because I was very fortunate again to find the journal, the 1943 journal of my grandfather, written in 43, daily. So maybe he thought that 60 years later I will write a book. But I found a very interesting piece. I found this piece, which for Algeria is quite unique, because Zionism was very, very, very weak in Algeria compared to Tunisia. And my grandfather did apply for the Union Sioniste Algérienne in a very important date, the 4th of April 43. It's 1 week after the second abrogation of the Crémieux decree. And it is also 1 week after the Manifesto of the Algerian People written by Ferhat Abbas, who said that how can we hope to gain the French citizenship if they don't give it back to Jews who had it for 70 years. Unfortunately, Ferhat Abbas will not see his dream because he will be disgarced from the free Algeria in 62, but it was very, very funny, let's say, to see the micro history of my grandfather and his frustration and his resentment against France, and at the same time the resentment of the Muslim Algerian against France as well. This is another, it's just an example of my grandfather writing in a journal which has been not the one for 43, it was a recycling of 41. You see, just have to raise the date. And he says this is a reestablishment of the Crémieux decree on the 21st of October 43. Then, after the Second World War, maybe there was 10 years of tranquility for the Jews of North Africa, let's say a second integration of the French culture and political environment. But at the end, they all left, as I was saying in my introduction. And maybe I will try to give you some insight of why. And I can say why now, because you have seen what the long and complex history before. Of course, the decolonization and the rebirth of the State of Israel weakened the situation of the million of Jews from Muslim world. But my understanding is that it's not the only cause by far. Many other reasons forced the Sephardic population to leave the country. First of all, the pogrom did exist before 48. I was mentioning in North Africa, I was mentioning Baghdad in 41, you could say in Libya in 45, so it was before 47, 48. And so it's true that France and Great Britain did protect, somehow, not always, this Jewish population from some violence coming from part of the Muslim population. They were, as neither colonizer nor colonized, they had some political rights, much more than the Muslim colonized population. And somehow, even if they didn't have the political consciousness of what was Al-Dima, because maybe they forget it, because for Algeria it was back to 1830, they maybe didn't want to go back to it, or at least being marginalized in country where Arabization and Islamization was growing. Some of the population also had some positive motivation to go to Israel, either from observant Jews or secular Zionists, in particular in Tunisia and Morocco, or Iraq or Egypt. And also, some new decolonized regime did not help or even forced the Jews to leave, in particular, not much in North Africa, but it was true in Egypt, Iraq, and Libya, who had some explicit anti-Semitic policies. And for so Tunisia and Morocco was a softer country, and for a period of time, some of the Jews thought it was possible to stay. In the case of Algeria, it's a unique case because with a very violent war of independence, the French population at the end left, and the Jews among them left as well. And so, at the end, Israel became the refuge for 600,000 Jews from Muslim country, while France did receive 300,000 Jews from North Africa, and among them the Cohen Tanuji. Most of the Cohen Tanuji went to France, and I will say why now. So this is just a map to give you the numbers. Most of the Sephardic community who took refuge in Israel were amputated of the elite who fled to France, Canada, Argentina, UK, and the US. This is important to compare the Sephardic population in Israel, for example, and in France or Canada. Most of those Jews were observant Jews and Arab speakers. They were installed in refugee camps at the periphery of Israel. They were marginalized socially and culturally in a society, a young Israeli society, which has been shaped by secular Ashkenazi pioneers. And here, the only Jewish population who tried to integrate them was the non-Zionist Lithuanian Jewish population. And this was later the creation of the Shas party in Israel. But nothing real compared to what used to be the Jewish tradition in North Africa. And of course, it took decades for those Mizrahi Jews, but Sephardic, so Western Oriental Jews, to reduce the social and economical gap for a population which represents now a small majority of the Jewish population of Israel. At the opposite, it's not the opposite too much now, but 40 years ago it was very different. Now the Israel is reducing the gap. But for the Sephardic population in France, it was much easier to integrate because, first of all, they were mostly French speakers and sometimes, like most of the Algerian Jews, French citizens. So they didn't feel they were immigrants. They were French moving from a province to another. They also benefit from the economical boom in the Trente Glorieuse, as we say in French, even if a portion of the Sephardic population still face social and economical difficulties in the French suburbs. And of course, we can measure the participation of this population to the French creativity in science, arts, and literatures. And I give you an example, is the Nobel Prize of my uncle. he got the Nobel Prize with Steve Chu from Stanford. So there is another Stanford connection. I would say maybe my uncle is a symbol of this Sephardic participation of the French creativity. We always have to find symbols, but this one was a good one. So this is the end of my presentation. I will give you, to conclude, a few key learnings. And maybe you will find me a little bit more a consultant than a historian, but even if there is still a few thousand of Jews in Morocco, Tunisia, Iran, Turkey, the Jewish presence in Muslim lands, we can say it's over, unfortunately. And to be a little bit provocative, I will say somehow Arab nationalism had succeeded where the Almohades failed, is emptying North Africa of its Jews. It's unfortunate to say that, but it's the reality. I will not stay with this black, dark image. First of all, I will try to push the French with North African Jewish roots to realize that they have an identity much more complex than only French pieds-noirs, which were the colonizers. They were not colonizers. They were before the French colonization, before the Turkish occupation, before before the Arab invasion. And I will say, also, it's important to understand the history to better qualify what was this new anti-Semitism in France. And of course, here is not a question of generalizations, but is really naming the facts. And somehow, those young guys who don't know history at all, consciously or unconsciously, they regenerate some violence which pre-existed in North Africa. Of course, it's different, but there is some roots. It's not only a social cause, but also there is some cultural causes. And to answer, to have a protection or prevention of this phenomenon, my feeling is the only way is to develop historical knowledge to deconstruct and to give consciousness of the memories of history. And of course, by doing so, sometimes I deconstruct some myths. And of course, I try to not reconstruct some new one. Of course, it's not a question to darken the situation, but is to really find the good contrast of what was good, what was bad. And I will say, compared to other historians, I will say that Jewish-Muslim Golden Age did exist, and I mentioned a few of them, the Umayyad, the Ottoman, the Tunisian. But you see, those Golden Age are limited in a specific period of time, especially when the Al-Dima laws were relaxed. And I would say Muslim creativity was high when they were very tolerant minorities. So this is very important learning. And saying that is also important to relativize this. And I will refer to a book of Mark Twain from Princeton. even if it was not so nice comparatively, apparently, with a comparative approach, it was better to live in a Muslim environment than in a Christian environment, especially in the Middle Age. So my message is a little bit gray, it's not black, it's not white, but my feeling that with this approach, with this family approach in the contextualization of the Jewish history of North Africa, I give you an answer, some answer, and of course, it's up to you to think freely about it. Thank you very much.